This week's episode, You're in Trouble.
You gotta calculate the curvature. Mop the curvature to be made the fish a leader.
Mr. Wong, are you gonna get that? Not this again.
It's a big Crosby birthday, and I'm the only one that care. He a wonderful man.
Yeah, wonderful at beating his children, maybe.
He wasn't great to me. I worked for him for 37 years, and now he's a dad. Boo-hoo-hoo-hoo.
He was old, Mr. Wong. Everyone dies.
Boo-hoo-hoo-hoo.
Okay, I wasn't going to do this, but you obviously need some cheering up. Mr. Wong, would you like to come and serve me at my cotillion in Memphis this weekend?
Memphis? That's where Elvis Presley live. He destroyed Big Crosby's career. Rock and roll devil music put our state through Big Crosby heart.
That's right, Memphis. Deluxe people in a deluxe setting. I'll let you go with me on one condition, though. You have to say the word cotillion.
Cotillion?
Try again.
Cotillion.
Almost.
Cotillion.
No. Co.
Co.
Till.
Till.
E.
E.
On.
On.
Now you're getting it?
Cotillion.
No, you lost it again.
Cotillion!
Okay. You can go.
Car. I can't find anything.
Mr. Wong, it's the exact same car you always drive.
No, it's a different. It's a southern town car. It's all a backward.
Backward? You mean the direction Bing Crosby would launch his red-headed son through a plate glass window?
Miss Pam, they're not nice.
Pull over. This is it.
Excuse me, Miss Pam. Could I get a little pocket of money? I need a tiny snack.
I thought you yellow people were so sly. Can't you live on your wits?
Miss Pam.
Say cotillion, and I'll give you $100.
Cotillion.
Oh, take it. But Mr. Wong, do not spend this money on booze.
Oh, cross my heart.
I mean it.
Just stick a needle in my eye. Elvis Aaron Presley. You fight your mother in the ass.
Sir. Put your hands up and your penis back in your pants.
Kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with the estate. Is it love or is it hate? Mr. Wong.
This week's episode, You're in Trouble.
Elvis Aaron Presley, you fight your mother in the ass. And now I piss on your grave. When I dump pee on you, I dig you up and fuck you in the eye socket. King of rock and roll. More like a king of killing a Bing Crosby.
Ooh,
yeah, take it. Take it like a rockabilly bitch. How you like that, rock and roll?
Sir, put your hands up and your penis back in your pants.
Uh-oh. You're in trouble now. Think, Wong, think. What would Big Crosby do? Skinny man, I want to show you something. Patty cake, baker's man. Bake me a cake as fast as you... Fuck yourself, you baby! Ah! have an explanation.
There you are. I've been worried sick.
Not enough to make a court or bail me out of jail.
I did call. I left a message. I asked you to pick up a pizza.
Pizza? Do you have any idea what I've been through? I was in the big house, a slammer, the calaboose. A colored man turned me into his girlfriend. I hitchhike home. You know what they say, ass, gas, grass, no one rides for free. Are you ass about pizza? I hate you, Miss Pam. You a bitch. Bitch cut hole. I quit.
Mr. Wong, I guess I should have gotten in the elevator and gone down to the atrium food court myself. I didn't realize. Mr. Wong, you're the most important person in my life. I don't want to lose you.
Gotcha!
Oh, you fuckface, I love you!
Oh, I love you too, Miss Pam!
Kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with me yesterday. Is it love or is it hate, Mr.
This week's episode, Yellow Fever.
Miss Pam, I can't go on. I need a drink. I die of thirst.
Why don't you just drink from that stagnant pool of water over there in that old abandoned tire?
Can you buy me butter filter water?
No.
Oh, Miss Pam. There's a bug in here.
Are you thirsty or not?
Oh. That better.
Mr. Wong, I need you to carry some bags of sand to the roof. What's wrong with you? You're even more yellow than normal.
Oh, I'm sick, Miss Pam. That Thai water gave me malaria. I read about it on the internet. Look.
Thai water, malaria. No cure. Boils your blood. Mr. Wong, I told you shouldn't have drank that tire water.
Oh, Miss Pam, you made me do it!
You're delirious. Tell you what, I sympathize with your situation, and I want to help you.
Oh, thank you, Miss Pam.
I'm giving you the day off. I'm going to do all the work you do for me by myself.
But I need medical attention! Don't leave! I only got one kidney!
And no distractions. Enjoy the day.
Come back, you round-eyed bitch!
Do you need some help with your box?
In a matter of speaking. My majordomo, Mr. Wong, normally takes care of such matters, but he's sick with malaria. I'm sparing no expense nursing him back to health.
What a coincidence. I'm a doctor.
I didn't notice.
If you want, I could stop by your place after work and take a look at Mr. Wong for you.
It's a date.
He'll need to take two of these pills 3 times a day.
I'm sure that's not the only thing you could pull out of your pants that could make someone well.
Ah! Where am I? I've never seen this room before. Am I dead?
No, Mr. Wong. You're resting comfortably in your room.
This isn't my room. I sleep on a 3-wooden plank. I have a brick for a pillow. I have no electrical outlet even. Just a light bulb.
He's not making any sense, Doctor. His brain is boiled. Let's let him rest. Thoughts?
Well, considering his age and the degree to which the disease is ravaging his body, I think I'll need to move into your apartment until he's well.
Whatever's best for Mr. Wong.
Kicking down the boulevard. So fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with me yesterday. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Yellow Fever, Part 2.
Thoughts?
Well, considering his age and the degree to which the disease is ravaging his body, I think I'll need to move into your apartment until he's well.
Whatever's best for Mr. Wong. Ranjan Maitra. Swiss, I take it?
No, Indian.
Really? My mother's mother had a servant who was Apache.
Oh, my head! I need more medicine. What kind of medicine got a peanut center? That red-nosed bitch tried to kill me!
So, tell me, is there a Mrs. Dr. Ranjan Maitra?
It's a kill. Only kill time.
People consider me a marvel of science. You see, I have virtually no gag reflex to speak of.
Join your ancestors in hell!
Ah! Alert. What the hell do you think you're doing?
You replaced my malaria medicine with the M&M candy treat. You bad lady! You tried to kill me!
You selfish son of a bitch! Are you this jealous and spiteful? All I ask is that you stay sick for 5 more weeks so I can land Dr. Ranjan Maitra. After everything I've done for you, is it so much to ask that you not sabotage my chance at true love? Is it? Is it?
I guess not.
Good, drink. How are we feeling this morning?
Nauseous, sweaty, and my skin is on fire.
Well, good news. Dr. Ranjan Maitra took me to a fundraiser for Third World Development last night, and I got to second base in the coat room. Drink up. I love you, Mr. Wong.
Go fuck yourself.
Kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with me yesterday. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Meet the Creep, Part 1.
And where are you going?
I told you I have a 2:30 appointment.
But it's 4 o'clock.
Yeah. That's what I say. I have a Falkland dentist appointment for 2:30.
I don't know what you're talking about. Take the trash to the basement.
Well, I'll take you to the trash, bitch.
You look like you've seen a yellow ghost.
Miss Pam, I'm in trouble. They finally found me.
Who? INS?
No, the Tong family. I chased a Mojong dragon in 62. Got a big gambling debt. Never pay. There's an ass in the hallway and he's she going to kill me.
Back up. There's an ass in whose ass in what hallway?
No. There's a killer assassin. What am I going to do?
Let me think. You're going to take the trash downstairs.
Oh, you signed my death warrant.
Ugh, I wish. Now, chop chop with the trash.
Ah! What is this? Wrong button! Stay cool, Wong. No problems. Everything okay? It's no spooky. Wapewee.
We'll be right back.
nasty as SS and tried to...
Kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with the estate. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Meet the Creep,
Part 2.
Oh, I'm fucked and I never even got kissed.
Well, well, look who it is, my old pal Wong. How's it hanging, compadre?
Just slightly left of a shit's veal.
Whoa, looks like you're in a little bit of a Peking pickle.
Oh, Bing, you gotta help me. What do I do?
Well, that's simple, Wong. You unscrew that old jot top and let that pickle free.
Unscrew the... What are you talking about? How we get a pickle jar? What the hell?
Use the force, Wong. Use the force. Use the force.
Uh-oh.
This is for you.
Oh, God, have you been drinking?
No!
Oh, Christ, you have been drinking. Get the mop.
No, I... I don't see his SS and tried to...
Are you finished?
You got to help me, Miss Pam.
Fine. Tell me, Wong, was the assassin a man or a woman?
Well, hard to tell. All dressed in black, ready to kill.
Would the assassin be comfortable in a coffee shop?
Oh, yeah, there's a beatnik vibe. He have a groovy edge to her.
Would the assassin also be at home in a funeral parlor?
Well, very much so. He very creepy. He creepy and he groovy. He creepy groovy.
Creepy groovy. Very good. Don't worry, Mr. Wong. I've completed a composite of the gender indeterminate assassin. Would you like to see it?
Oh, that's not funny. No! Oh, no, Miss Pam, he's she here!
Mr. Wong, assassins don't ring doorbells. Dear God, it is an assassin.
It's no assassin! It's just a new neighbor!
What a nice card!
Well, it looks like I'm not the only one who needs a tooth for the appointment.
Oh, Wong, what a marvelous fucked up world this is.
All the scientists are running around looking for the monkey, but he can't be found because he's down by the pond playing hockey with the kids.
Oh, hey kids, Bing Bong, who's here? The Music Man with this week's episode, and it's a fabulous salute to pop music. It's bathed in a cavalcade of color, and it's coming in at number 8 on the German Hit Parade. Here's little Davy Jones with Mr. Wong.
Kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me. No matter what the weather, I'll be by her side. We're gonna stick together until one of us dies.
Just call for Mr. Wong. Call for Mr. Wong. He came with the estate. Is it love or is it hate with Mr. Wong? Mr. Wong.
When you got an errand, please remember that he's old. And just because he's yellow doesn't mean he's made of gold. Maybe he is cranky, and maybe he's a drunk. Possibly he's lazy and gambled way too much.
But call for Mr. Wong. Call for Mr. Wong. And you know.
Down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with the estate. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Treasure Cat, Part 1.
Time for spring cleaning. Gotta throw away some crap. Ah, it's my old opium pipe. I wonder if it still work. I better light up for old time to chase the dragon.
Oh, yeah.
Me? Why, I'm Treasure Cat.
Treasure Cat?
That's right, and my treasure senses are tingling. Wong, you've got a gold mine there in that closet of yours.
I do?
Tell me, Wong, what are the two greatest words in the English language?
Nickel slots?
No! Yard sale. Let's get rich.
Fuck yeah!
Hey, how much for these 46 pages of Moby Dick?
Hey, Treasure Cat, how much for these 46 pages of a Moby Dick?
£12 sterling.
£12 sterling.
Ooh, look who's out on the street selling their effluvium like a common street criminal.
Oh, Miss Pam, Miss Pam! Treasure Cat is helping me make a fortune for my closet career. You see, his treasure senses are tingling.
I'm sure it's nothing a little penicillin can't clear up. The ice better be cold for happy hour.
That woman sure is a sour cup of cunt.
Oh, Miss Pam! Nah, she's nice once you get to know her. She just a shy is all. More vodka to raise a cat?
It's hair of the dog and all that. 1500, 1501, 1502 shillings. Bravo, Wong. Today was a ringing success.
Thank you, treasure cat.
Are you thinking what I'm thinking?
Oh, we should look for treasure in the sewer?
Bingo.
It's happening.
Oh, where?
Treasure senses tingling.
To the west.
Oh, Wong, good, you're back. I need you to recalibrate the level on the Monet. And, what is that smell? Oh, fucking gross!
Miss Pam, look what I found in the sewers! I have a bottle cap, a rusty pop can, all very old, all very collectible. And this is just the beginning.
Oh, that's it. No more sewers. And the raccoon either stays in your room or gets mailed COD to the CDC.
Okay.
And you better take a Silkwood shower before you start preparing anything resembling food.
Yes, Miss Pam. Nowhere, treasure cat. It looks like our run of luck is over. No more treasure for us.
Wong, you deliciously dim Chinaman. Sometimes the greatest treasure is right under your nose.
Oh, yeah.
Miss Pam dropped a dime on treasure cat.
That cocksucking whore! Now what do we do?
Down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with the estate. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Treasure Cat, Part 2.
I never have a paper for treasure cat. You complete me.
Well, you've managed to complete me too, Mr. Wong.
Wong, have you seen the Monet? Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, we got some Monet for your Monet. And this time we got in dollars. 12 Canadian.
I'm so parched all of a sudden. Mr. Wong, could you run to the kitchen and fix me an Arnold Palmer?
Oh, right away, Miss Pam. Arnie and Palmer, half a iced tea, a half a lemonade, coming right up. Here you go, Miss Pam. One Arnie Palmer for you to enjoy. Where's Treasure Cat?
Ooh, your raccoon had to leave suddenly. He left this note for you.
Dear old man, I had to go. Bye. Sincerely, the raccoon. Creepy groovy treasure cat left me. Look.
Wong, this is a forgery. Treasure cat did not write this note.
Does it say what?
From the looks of it, it was written by Miss Pam.
Oh, that nunca bitch! So what happened to Teresa Cat?
Let's see. I'll just trace her phone activity and... Damn! Just what I was afraid of. A call was placed 13 minutes ago to animal control. Miss Pam dropped a dime on Treasure Cat.
Oh, that cocksucking whore! Now what do we do?
Bust his shit out of the hooscow. Okay, here's what we do. We go in nice and easy style. We'll wear these disguises in case things get a little weird. You remember what to do.
I think so, yeah.
Good. Put this gun in your pants.
Woo-hoo-hoo! That's a cold! Woo! Oh, actually, that'd be kind of nice.
Okay, let's take this yellow brick road to M.F.N. Oz.
May I help you?
My name is Mr. Smith. And this is my daughter, wife, Mrs. Creepy Smith Groovy. And we're looking for a pet treasure cat. He's blue. He speaks Dutch and he has a monocle.
All we got is a one-eyed raccoon with syphilis who's constantly choking on his own vomit.
Oh, that's him! That's him!
If you want him back, you'll have to pay a $20 processing fee and sign right here.
Oh, here, you sign it!
No way, Jack. Me no scribbly. Too many jackasses out there who'd kill to know where I am.
Well, I can't do it. I signed this. Next thing I know, I'm in a concentration camp making salt shakers for the North Koreans.
Damn. Fucking impasse. Eureka!
What?
Let's get weird. Treasure cat, your ass is about to save ours.
Kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with me yesterday. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Treasure Cat, Part 3.
Okay, if my recon is correct, and sidebar always is, then we are directly above and to the right 1/2 degree of Treasure Cat.
So close. I can practically taste his warm breath. We're coming, Treasure Cat. Oh, such a beautiful light.
Try not to look directly at the laser. You'll go blind.
Uh-oh.
It's Bravo Hour. Ha! It's clear! Move!
Ow!
Are you okay?
just my trick hip. I'm fine.
Frog to lily pad, we have contact!
Treasure cat!
No time for emotion. We have 40 seconds. And go! Just what I was afraid of. Floor-to-ceiling invisible lasers. There's only one way out, Treasure Cat. Your ass is about to save ours. They'll never get me alive.
Oh boy, we fucked now! She hit the map!
Kill Miss Fortune.
Wong, thank God, there you are. It's a good thing I installed that tracking device in your forearm while you were sleeping.
Hooray! Look, Treasure Cat, Miss Pam come to save us.
Yeah, actually, I was wondering where we keep the ice.
In the freezer.
And a freezer is?
Something that freezes things.
And that is located in my...
kitchen.
And I'd find that...
next to the living room.
Which is where, ...
First on the right.
Great then, thanks so much.
Oh, Miss Pam, I was wondering if we could get a little ride back to town. I have infected the blister on my feet.
Toodles!
Oh well, we still saved. Let's go home, Treasure Cat.
I'm sorry, Wong. I can't go. That's not my home.
What?
I am a magical creature of the world. My heart belongs to the moonlight. I belong to no one, no place, no thing.
What? But you just said you hop along to the fucking moonlight.
That's not mixed words, Wong.
I'm a rambling animal, a star catcher.
I can't remain in any one place. But know this.
Wherever the rainbow touches the moon, wherever a trout licks the hand of a farmer, my spirit will be there, watching over you.
Please, treasure cat, don't leave!
Lief long, unverspoedig.
What's that?
It's Dutch, Wong. Dutch.
Ah, gotcha!
What is it, Fred?
Wee-wee-wee-wee-wee. It's a squirrel dressed up like Abe Lincoln.
Put him in the bag. We'll fuck him in the back of the truck.
Wee-wee-wee-wee.
Kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with me yesterday. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Gary Peterson's Wonder Wand, Part 1.
So, what I'm saying, Wong, is that you cannot afford not to invest in my Belgian water magnetizing system.
I sold, Gary. You have to go so soon, Gary? Stay! I'll make you a hot dog, but brain food, even though you don't need it. You're so smart anyway.
I would love to, Wong, but due to the present temperature discomfiture, vis-a-vis the hot summer weather, I need to lie down in the back of my Buick Sabre and take a nap.
Okay, whatever you say, Gary. Take a break. Rest that brain of yours. It's so big.
Okay, Wong. I'll be in touch.
Stop right there.
What?
There are $211 missing from the curse kitty. Donde vas the cash?
I used it to invest in the new breakthrough Belgian water magnetizing system with my friend Gary Peterson. He a genius. We can't afford not to invest.
Oh, Christ, Wong, you'd be better off cramming that cash up the ass of a dead rooster.
What do you mean?
Gary Peterson is a loser, grifter, con man, ne'er-do-well, swindler, artiste du con, phony, fraud, fake. Not to mention the fact that he smells like cabbage.
What are you saying? He a good man. I'd like you to be his friend.
He's cast a spell on you, Wong. He's dazzled you with his mediocrity. And now I have no choice but to save you from yourself. You owe me 211. That equals one air conditioner.
Oh, no, Miss Pam. It's too hot. You take away my air conditioner, I'll drown in my own ass sweat juice.
Believe me, Wong, you'll thank me later. And by the beehive, bye-bye. As long as I breathe God's sweet air, Gary Peterson is to never step foot in this house again. Got it?
Okay.
Don't push me, mister! I can take away your meats and vegetables, too.
I got it!
Good.
Eat my food bowl, bitch! Mr. Pamarez, thanks.
Oh, Wong. I'm on my way over to your house with the shipment of Belgian water magnetizers.
Oh, no, Gary. We have a problem. You're not allowed to come over.
I don't understand.
Mrs. Pam, she's angry about the money I gave you.
She can't afford to be angry. This is too good an opportunity to pass up.
I know. I'm sorry, Gary.
Well, Wong, I'd hate to have to find a new partner for this $1 million venture.
We do it! Come over at midnight. I sneak you in.
Ugh.
Just steady my shoulders, Wong, and let the centrifugal force of my leg swing vault my body upwards.
You're so smart, Gary Peterson. Look, okay.
Mr. Wong, I need to talk to you.
Week's episode, Gary Peterson's Wonder Wand, Part 2.
I'm experiencing a feeling I've never felt before. The dictionary says it's called sympathy. I want to give you your air conditioner back.
No. I like it hot. It good for my complexion.
No, I insist.
No, you teach me a lesson, Miss Pam. I love lesson. You made me so happy.
Really? You mean I was right to leave an 85-year-old man in a 600-degree room?
Super right. Very super right.
Well, how about that? You know what? I will never engage in a moment of self-doubt again. Thank you, Wong.
No. Thank you, Miss Pam. God damn it.
You realize you have virtually shut the door on any reasonable treatment from that woman in the future.
Ah, fuck her! Soon I'll be a millionaire! I'll buy a golden steamroller and squish her flat like a pancake!
What we need to do is place these water magnetizers in these plastic sleeves and seal them for shipment back to Belgium.
Got it!
It really is hotter than a shithouse flower in here.
That sleeve a little small, Gary. Gary, your wand is too big to fit.
No, it's almost in, Wong. Just relax.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's good. Now push harder.
No fucking way.
Oh, no, Miss Pam, it's not what it looked like.
Oh, fuck me running. The old chink's gone homo.
Oh, Miss Pam, I'm sorry. I can explain.
No need, Wong. You are who you are. To be honest, I've had my suspicions all along.
So you're not mad about Gary being here?
I don't judge, Wong. If I did, who would do my hair and select my wardrobe?
So it okay if Gary stay here tonight so we can cram more wands?
A good rule of thumb here will be, the less I know, the better.
Thanks, Miss Pam. What a nice lady.
Dada, a lot of people don't understand how you fell in love with Ryan.
I know! It's hard to look at a guy who's just a head floating in a jar and say, hey, he'd make a great boyfriend. But when you hang out with someone like Ryan, who's so super smart and fills your head with new ideas, well, it's like having a mental orgasm.
Yeah! Wong?
Yes, Miss Pam?
Considering your current proclivity toward men, I was wondering, don't you think you could find a better new friend than Gary Peterson? I mean, if you wanted, I could introduce you to someone really great and hot from the gym.
Oh, that's not necessary, Miss Pam. I'm lucky Gary Peterson picked me to be his partner.
Yeah, but he's so, I don't know, how do the French say it? Revolté? I mean, tell me, what do you see in him anyway?
Wow, he kind, he's smart. He have great ideas.
Mental orgasm.
Well, like that girl say on the television talk show, he shoot jizz into my brain.
Oh, my God.
Oh, I know. He, every time I with him, he squirt man juice on my head.
Oh, sweet Jesus fucking Lord.
That's right. He make me have a skull full of spermatozoa.
Okay, I've heard enough. Very good. Here's what we do. I go to my room and take a bath for the next 12 and a half, say, hours, and I try to wash that image from my brain. Forever.
Okay, Miss Pam.
Ba-ba-ba-ba.
kicking down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just missed Pam and me.
He came with the estate. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode, Gary Peterson's Wonder Wand, Part 3.
Hello there, Gary.
Hello, Miss Pam.
Gary, now that you're Mr. Wong's new friend, and no offense, but I don't know why anyone would go gay with you or otherwise, I'll be expecting you to pitch in with the housework.
But I don't think that...
The only but you should worry about, my friend, is the little withered yellow one that's going to be jammed in your face come nightfall. Good day to you.
I am a serious one. I am quite sure that Miss Pam is convinced that we, you and I, are engaged in some homosexual hanky-panky.
That crazy! She don't think that!
Believe me, Wong, she really does. She even asked for my design tips on her new bedroom sitting area.
Oh, really? What did you say?
Well, I thought the heavy fabric on the divan would take away from the subtle lines on the marble inlay.
Well, that's a good instinct. At first, I thought the drapes could pull the room together and... Wait a minute! This is crazy! We're not a gay lover!
I know that. The only time I ever did anything remotely gay was when I joined the men's wrestling team in college. And I assure you, Wong, that sticky incident was purely accidental.
Well, look on the bright side. At least we don't have the whole bitch's interference with our million-dollar venture. Million. Million. Million.
That's true.
Hey, I got an idea. You want to show that red cracker neck jack Miss Pam once and for all?
Does it involve misunderstanding and hijinks?
Oh, you bet! Very much so!
I am in.
Sorry, Gary.
Oh, shit!
Gotcha!
What?
It was a joke on you!
So you're really not in bed, naked, giving Gary Peterson a humming BJ?
No, I am, but I do for a joke! You fell for it!
That's right, Miss Pam. This time, the laugh is truly upon you.
Okay, but let's recap. Mr. Wong, you really were putting the tongue lather to Gary Peterson's man sausage.
Oh, yeah, of course. But only so you think that we...
Oh.
Good night, boys.
Say my name, Wong. Who is your daddy?
Joke's over! No, you know what? Ow! Come on, Gary, exit only. Cut it out!
This week's episode, Stand Up for Wong.
Look, it's a cow menorah. I hate myself.
Ooh, tough crowd. You're next, creepy. Remember, you read these hilarious jokes I download from the internet, and that cash prize money is ours.
I don't think I can do this, Mr. Wong.
Suck it up, creepy! And don't forget your signature move. Good stuff!
Tora, Tora, Tora. Thank you, good night.
Thank you, Mazel Top, the people of Judea's favorite prop comic. And now let's have a warm round of applause for the comedy stylings of Creepy Groovy!
What do you call a cow caught in a tornado hold for a beat. A milkshake. Why do mice gather together at photo shoots? Because the photographer's always saying cheese. A blonde, a Jew, and an Irish priest are on in line at the gates of heaven behind Tony Curtis.
You suck!
I knew this was gonna be a big mistake. Oh, God.
Oh, shame on you, Chuckle Chuff audience! You got funny lady telling comedy jokes with fantastic comedy styling! All she want to do is bring joy into your miserable, pathetic, pus-filled, crap-ridden lives, and you shut her down like a Thanksgiving turkey! Shame on you! Shame! Shame, shame, shame on you!
Shut your eyes, all you yellow-soaked, slutty-eyed son of a panda fucking chicken China man!
Chink? Chink? Buddy, for your information, I'm an American! A-M-E-R-I-K-E-N! American! A number one! I may be of a Chinese descent, but I am an American! Not a nip, a gook, a slant, or a chink! I'm not a zipper head, a slope, an uncle ho, you old bastard! Rice burglar, monkey chaser, ringtail, rice belly, or an I Chi Chi, or a Chow Mein Charlie! Those names are meant to hurt people's feelings. How could you use such words in the land of the free and the home of the brave? In this, the greatest melting pot of the 47 states of the United America? It is just for precisely this reason that the forebears of this great country of ours fought against the tyranny of the Australians so that we could be free from their bondage. So that all Americans could be treated equally. All colors, the red, the white, the black and the blue and the yellow, united against ignorance. And you, sir, you better think before you use words that you are unable to be equipped to use to handle.
Gotcha!
Dad? Surprise!
Did you really think we'd forget your birthday?
Oh, Miss Ben, you remember! This is just like that shitty movie with Sean Penn and Michael Douglas.
The game, exactly. Except I won't push you to your fake death through 37 floors of glass.
Othello, for he's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow, which nobody can deny.
I just crap my pants. Oh, this is the best birthday ever!
Down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with me yesterday. Is it love or is it hate, Mr. Wong?
This week's episode.
Bye, baby.
I can't. You're a great new boyfriend. You really know how to deliver the goods, especially in the rack. What the hell's wrong with you? Did the supermarket run out of rice?
No, I'm all backed up with the main fluid, and you're lubed up like a Texas oil well.
Hard up.
Any harder up and I would have hoarded 7 donuts without any hands.
7? Really? Tell you what, let's get you back in the saddle. Kent works at a nursing home. I'll have him introduce you to some easy geezer so you can get your rocks off.
Miss Pam, would you do that for me?
Mr. Wong, I love you. Of course I would help you slice off a piece.
Oh, Miss Pam, you're so nice.
Now hit it and give me 3 push-ups.
But you know I have no cartilage in my shoulder sockets.
I know.
Oh, Miss Pam.
Seriously.
Oh, I hope this double day work out. How do I look?
Like a bag of yellow wrinkles that hasn't been laid since the Truman administration. Ooh, there's Kent now.
Hey, sweet pets.
So, Kent, this Sandra, she a nice lady?
Nice. Believe me, guys, she's gonna put some wood under your hood.
Looks like she already has.
Oh, Miss Pam. So, Sandra, it must be fun down at the nursing home with Kent.
Yeah, we do all kinds of stuff. Ping pong, raffles, and ping pong.
Ooh, sounds tremendously exciting.
Looks like these two lovebirds are really hitting it off.
Oh yeah, Sandra's a fantastic lady.
Mr. Wong, can I speak with you in the bathroom for a moment?
Right away, Miss Pam. Excuse me, Sandra. Oh, I shouldn't be in here. It's a ladies' room.
Oh, relax. Some of the women in here have bigger dicks than you. Look, Wong, here's the plan. I got you a room at the third most expensive motor hotel in the city. Kent and I are going back to my place to make like monkeys in every single room. I suggest you take that calcified Venus of yours and do likewise.
Oh, you think she wants it?
Wants it? She's practically begging for it. Now get out. Yes. Where the fuck is my date, you rodent?
Oh, Miss Pam, Miss Pam. Wait a sec, Sandra and Kent left together. Oh, look, kissy kissy.
No fucking way.
That's right. Turns out Kent is an A number one, USDA 100% granny grabber.
My Kent? No!
Yellow man!
No, bring no, 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 no!
Ow, yellow man! Ow, 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 ow. No, it's Pam! No! Ow! Ow! Ow. Oh. It's not your fault. It's not your fault.
God damn. Feels like my coos has received more pounds than a British bank. Wait a moment, Tito. You and I, we did not.
Oh, yeah. 11 times. And you were purring like a German sports car.
Listen, you, this never happened. And if you mention one fucking word of this, I will paddle your balls back to Beijing with a cricket bat.
Promise?
Down the boulevard, so fun and fancy free. Got a pocket full of sunshine, just Miss Pam and me.
He came with the estate. Is it love or is it hate? Mr. Wong.
Oh, Mamie. You're one hot lady.
And you're way hotter, Wong. In fact, why don't you give me a peek at your hot Wong?
Oh, Mamie, do it. Do it, Mamie. Do it, do it. Oh. Mamie, you look so hot.
What? In this whole thing?
Oh, yeah. Shake it. Shake it hard. Ooh, she's in the drink. Here I come, my sweet.
I love you, you little freak.
Oh, I love you too, Mamie.
And here he is, the sexiest man this side of the Khyber Pass. You can captain my ship anytime. In my ship, I mean, vagina.
Oh, Mamie, you're the sexiest lady. Such a sexy way with a word. You keep talking like that, Mamie, and I'll be able to pull the choke with no hands.
Oh, wow.
Look who it is, my old pal Wong. How's it hang?
I do? Tell me, Wong, what are the two greatest words in the English language?
Organ grinder?
Tell me, Wong, what are the two greatest words in the English language?
Hand job? No, I kid, okay, let's try it again. Crotchless panties. Buck teeth.
Miss Pam, I can't go on. I need a drink.
Excuse me, Miss Pam. Could I get a little pocket of money? I need a tiny snack. Check out my low mane.
Oh my God, you get me with that every time. Wonderful. Well done.
Forget your personal tragedy. We are all bitched from the start, and you especially have to be hurt like hell before you can write seriously. But when you get the damn hurt, use it. Don't cheat with it. Be as faithful to it as a scientist. But don't think anything, if it happens to you, is of any importance just because it's you or anyone belonging to you. Those words of advice are written to F. Scott Fitzgerald from Ernest Hemingway in 1934. That same advice gave me the guts not to cheat with the truth, to tell it as it is. And that spirit, Papa Hemingway, don't take affront to what follows. In the spring of 1991, I finally met the lady I had longed to meet for years, the statuesque beauty Margot Hemingway. All the attraction, love, lust, call it what you want, but it was instant 4th of July fireworks from the start. A month or so after, we flew to Saint-Tropez and Paris. How darling she was, toasting our being together for all my birthdays to come. At one point she whispered, "There are a lot of girls out there who are jealous of us. Always know I would never use you in any way." I quickly interrupted, "Margot, my ego is far too big to believe that you would. It could be, though, I'm using you." Ordering another bottle of Dom Perignon Pink, we embraced, kissed, and must have looked like two overage high school kids, certainly I must have. The waiter filled our glasses from the new bottle. Kissing the top of her nose, I toasted to love, not revenge. Paying little heed to my toast, Margot purred to lust and more lust. "I know you're a papa's favorite," I told her. "He was mine too, always will be," she whispered back. Then I let it flow. When we were shooting The Sun Also Rises in Morelia, he never stopped talking about his little Margot. Couldn't hear everything because he never talked to me directly. Never looked at me directly either. Papa was sure one unhappy author. I think he talked more about me than you, how this Jew boy from New York was going to ruin his best work. The first time he saw me on location, he looked at me, pointed his finger square at my nose, turned to the director. "Him playing Pedro Romero opposite Ava Gardner? No way, not if I have anything to say about it." And he had plenty to say. Didn't keep his feelings to himself either. Everyone in the set knew Papa's thought about how this Jew boy would ruin his film and his prize novel. I laughed, yeah, but he couldn't convince Zanuck. Zanuck was the producer, and he wanted only one person to play Romero, the bullfighter, and that was me. Though I didn't want to, I couldn't help but laugh again. Papa? Nothing would have gotten him off more than seeing me stabbed in the cojones by a bull's horn. Yeah, one thing, seeing me dead. Pouring the last of the bottle's pink champagne, I reflected. Instead, he's dead, and I'm alive, drinking pink champagne with his favorite of favorites. Maybe it was the champagne, but more possibly 30 years of pent-up anger. I was on a roll. He was one hell of a sore loser, too. When the picture opened in the summer of 57, the little Jew boy copped all the reviews. A month later, I'm at Yankee Stadium watching the seventh game of the World Series. Who's sitting two boxes away from me? The man himself, Papa Hemingway. Feeling pretty good about myself, I walked over to him like an idiot, telling him how great it was to see him again. He gives me a quick look. He didn't even say hello, and he turns his head to see if Mickey Mantle struck out. And here I am, enjoying the best birthday since I started shaving. Can't lie to you, Margot. I don't know which is more of a turn-on. Being with you or thinking of Papa Hemingway turning over in his grave, knowing this little over-the-hill Jew boy and his favorite of favorites are not only together, but in love. Expecting the worst, I once again learned that when it comes to a woman's mind, I know nothing. Did she get up and walk out? No. Did she slap me across my face? No. Was she angered at my duplicitous thoughts? I'll never know. She never said a fucking word about it. Instead, she bit my earlobe and kissed me. Me? I would be surprised if, for some sick reason, the more I put Papa down, the more it turned her on. I never asked. She'd never tell me anyway. It sure proves, though, telling the truth doesn't hurt. Together, we spent one long, hot summer in Saint-Tropez. My son Joshua rudely awakened me on a blistering August morning in the summer of 1993. Daddy, I didn't want to awaken you, but I'm leaving for the beach, and I have to tell you what happened last night. Natasha and I went to Club A, Mickey Rourke's new place. He was there, too, at another table across the room. I didn't even know he knew me. But suddenly two guys come over to the table and ask me if I'm Bob Evans' kids. I tell them yes. Then they tell me to leave. I couldn't believe it. I asked them why. One of them, a big guy, must have been 6'6", pulls my chair out and says, "Just get out of here, kid. Forget the tab. If you're Evans' kids, the boss don't want you here." A rude awakening. I was hotter than the weather. I picked up the phone and dialed the Mandarin Hotel. "Daddy, I didn't want to cause a problem. Then you shouldn't have told it to me." The hotel operator plugged in. "Good morning, the Mandarin. Marco Riccardi, please." "He's at the pool. Should I page him there?" "Just get him on the phone." "Well, pardon me." I didn't answer her. Marco, a friend of mine for years, knew Mickey well. Unfortunately for him, he picked up my page at the pool. "Marco, it's Evans. Stranger." That's all he could get out of his mouth. "You know where Mickey Rourke is?" "Yeah," interrupting him. "Find the motherfucker today. Tell him when it comes to me, he can do or say anything he wants to get himself off. But fucking over my kid, that's different. I'm going to shove a broken bat up his ass." "Evans, I can't believe that I'm hearing this from you. You're too cool a guy." "Well, believe it. I want to sit down with this punk today. He plays tough, but he's still a fucking actor to me." Marco starts to laugh. "What are you laughing about?" "He's sitting right across from the pool." "I know he's trying to temper me." "If you're waiting for me to cool down, don't." Okay. I could almost grab him from here." "Then do it." "Tell him that I said exactly what I said, and don't soft pedal it, Marco. Set a time, call me back," and I smashed the phone right in his ear. Joshua knew he had pushed the wrong button telling me the story. It started 15 years earlier, in January of 79. To be exact, I was in Las Vegas directing various tennis scenes with Pancho Gonzalez and many of the tennis greats for players, the film I was producing. It was January 16th, Joshua's 18th birthday. His mother was out of the country. I arranged for my butler, David, to bring Joshua to Las Vegas for his birthday. Luckily, it fell on a Friday, allowing us the weekend together. We had a blast, he by my side asking me 1,000 questions while I directed one tennis sequence after another. An up-and-coming 18-year-old tennis pro, who at the time was too shy to utter the three words he had given in the film, was teaching my son how to hit the ball with his racket, his name John McEnroe. It was birthday night, and my good friend Mort Viner, who at the time was Dean Martin's manager, arranged front and center table for six at Dean's one-man show at the MGM Grand. At the time, Dean was Vegas' biggest attraction. His cardinal rule is never to break stride during performance to introduce anyone, no matter how big the celebrity. With cake and all, eight candles burning, there walked Dean center stage. He got down on one knee and crooned "Happy Birthday" to my little runt. And Joshua blew out the candles to the applause of about 2,000 people. Did it excite Joshua? I think so. Did it excite me? Big. What does this have to do with Mickey Rourke? Plenty. Debbie Fuhrer, a beautiful young actress whose family lived in Las Vegas, was my date for the evening, our first. To quote Claude Rains's line to Humphrey Bogart in Casablanca, it was the beginning of a beautiful romance. 4 years later, Deborah's last name changed to Rourke, Mrs. Mickey Rourke. Though I knew her before Mickey ever set foot in California, it mattered little. With purpose, he'd never say hello, never step a foot in my house, and made it known that it'd be best for my health not to be in the same room with him. Ironically, I was a great fan of his, believing his presence on the screen was singular. As the 80s progressed, so did Mickey's career. He became the hot new stud, exuding danger onto the silver screen. He was a number one on every ladies' heat list. Yet, until that blistering Sunday in August of 93, never a word was uttered between us. The phone rang again. It was Marco. Evans, I don't know how to tell you this, but when I walked over to tell Mickey you wanted to see him, his whole body began to shake. What did you do, this guy? Did you tell him what I said, Marco? I couldn't. He got up and walked to the other end of the pool. I'm watching him right now. He's still shaking. I don't give a shit what he's doing, Marco. Arrange a sit-down with this punk actor tomorrow, and I mean it. Trust me, Bob, the timing's wrong. Marco, I don't want weather reports. Arrange it. Call me back when you do. Marco didn't call me back the next morning, but he did the next day. Are you sure you want this, Evans? I didn't hear you, Marco. Did you arrange it? Yeah, tomorrow I'd want at his place. At his place? Yeah, that's the only place he'll meet. Pick me up at 12:45 then, okay? We'll drive there together. At 12:45 exactly, Marco was at my doorstep. Me, I was dressed and ready for a showdown time. I slid into Marco's car. Let's get it on. Bob, I gotta tell you, I was with Mickey last night. When I brought your name up, he began to hyperventilate. I had to put a grocery bag over his head. You sure you want to go through with this? Marco, drive. We walked into Rourke's office 3 minutes before the strike of one and stood in his anteroom. On the right was a large office, on the left a smaller one, but no Mickey. The secretary said, Mr. Rourke will be here soon, gesturing for us to sit in the larger office. Well, I want the smaller one. Is that all right with you, miss? Well, okay, if that's what you want, that's what I want. 5 minutes turned into 10, 10 into 15, 15 into 20. Still we sat, still no Rourke. You couldn't help but notice that every inch of the wall space of the 20 by 20 foot office was covered with pictures, pictures of the same woman in every extraordinary pose possible. What a beauty. The lady was the flame of his life as well, named Carrie Otis. It was now close to 1:30. In walked Rourke, sleeveless, his tattooed arms bulging with muscles. Behind him were two goons who could easily have been George Foreman's bouncers. Mickey approached me. I stood, our eyes locked. Putting one hand on each of his shoulders, I said something I'd never chance again. Before we start, Mickey, I want you to know I fucked Carrie Otis too. Marco's face turns ashen. Mickey's beat red. Slowly, Mickey did a double take until our eyes locked again. For that split second, he wanted to break me in half and take out my eyes as well. Before he had a chance to do either, I whispered, I never even met you, dumb fuck. A Tyson Wright couldn't have floored him better. Our noses no more than an inch apart, Mickey hissed. What are you trying to tell me? I'd never laid eyes on her, that's what. You're fucking crazy. You're fucking crazy, Evans. I could have done some heavy damage to you. Well, big boy, after 15 years of not talking, how the hell else am I going to get Shocky into some sense? You are nuts. You know it, don't you? Now tell me the truth. I told you I never even met her. Looking around at the two goons behind him, Rourke said, this guy has some fucking cojones. Then turning to me again, you sure you don't know her? How many times do I have to tell you? I've never met her. Rourke threw Marco a glance. Who the fuck is this guy? Marco shook his head. I told you, Mickey, he's one of us. Turning quickly back to me. I could have whacked you. I know. You know, you are fucking nuts, too, as I know. If you've got the guts to pull this shit on me and come out whole, you own me, got it? Yeah, I got it, and I'm gonna own you. Now let's get out of this joint and break bread in my joint. 3 hours later, sitting under my several hundred-year sycamore tree, still mundering on grilled chicken sausages with linguine, marinara, Mickey, his two goombas, Marco, and I couldn't stop laughing about the rough road we both left behind. Again, quoting Claude Rains, it was the start of a beautiful romance, but this time with a bit of loyalty thrown in. Just as my career had gone south in the 80s, Mickey's did in the 90s. But make no mistake, it's only temporary. Why? He has more screen presence by accident than almost any leading man in town. Bad decisions served him roughly, possibly justly, but that's not for me to judge. Rourke is somewhat reminiscent of Brando, who 25 years ago had to work for scale on The Godfather. At that moment in time, no one would touch him. The Godfather delivered Brando not back to stardom, but to superstardom. Talent, like cream, does float to the top, as did Brando, as will Mickey. Let someone tell me I can't use Rourke in a flick. They'll get the same answer I gave 25 years ago when I was told unequivocally by the suits upstairs that Brando would play Don Corleone over their dead bodies. While their bodies are dead, I'm still alive, and so is Rourke.